Carin and welcome to the celebration for the life of Lee Sechrest Allen. I want to tell you on behalf of the family, they appreciate the expressions of care and sympathy these last few days and so thankful for each one of you. When Gene Wiggins and I met with the family to plan this service today, Jill showed me this book, which belonged to Ms. Allen, a gift she had received in 1954. That's how old I am. That's that old. It written on the inside, presented to Joy Lee Sechrest by Mrs. J.D. Berry, 1954. She wanted to see if she had a favorite verse or thought that we could share from this book. Jill said her mother read from this book as long as she could remember. She would open it and read it after her husband had gone to bed sometimes and she was still awake. Jill found her mother reading it when she was unable to sleep and would join her. You can see that this book is well-worn, yellowed pages, and a lot of tape holding it together, so you use this a lot. It's called Daily Strength for Daily Need. I noticed many sections were corner marked, which looked like a place you referred to often. And I'm going to share with you one thought that was very appropriate for today. And this was written by a man named William Law. If anyone would tell you the shortest, surest way to all happiness and all perfection, he must tell you to make it a rule to yourself to thank and praise God for everything that happened to you. For it is certain that whatever seemingly calamity happened to you, if you thank and praise God for it, you turn it into a blessing. Could you, therefore, work miracles you could not do more yourself than by the thankful spirit? For it heals with the word speaking and turns all that it touches into happiness. Join me in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come today happy that Joy Allen had finally gained that for which she had worked and served and now received through thy grace. But we also come today, our Father, with a very heavy heart. Because we love someone, we are never quite ready to give her up. Her footprint, Father, have been felt and will be seen in many places in the days to come. So we thank you for sharing her life with us. I pray a special blessing upon her family and to the many who filled this sanctuary today. We give you thanks. We are never the same when we come to a service like this. And may we remember, let the circle be unbroken. In Jesus' name, amen.
As we remember our dear friend, one that all of us who are here today remember and appreciate the relationships that we had in special ways. But all of us know that she had something that was very important to her in her life. Almost we could say it was like a part of the very fabric of her life, and that is God and God's Word. And I think Joy would have us feel it was inappropriate if we did not begin this service by standing together, honoring God, and sharing in His Word in a responsive way. Please join me. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Then I heard a voice from heaven say, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Yes, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works will follow them. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. And amen, and amen. You may be seated.
Hi, how are you all? I'm Jennifer Allen. That was my niece and her husband. And I told my sister earlier, I said, seriously, I have to follow that? I'm here to tell you a little bit about Mom and some memories. And there are a lot of familiar faces and a lot of people who knew her throughout life and through periods of life and later in life. And so some of these things that I'm going to share are not going to be surprising. Some might. Those who knew Mom and knew her well, you know that she was the original Martha Stewart. Martha had nothing on Mom. She took great delight in entertaining, and it made her happy. And putting, you know, crossing the T's and dotting the I's. So much so that I'm pretty sure I was the only kid in my entire friend group who at slumber parties in the morning had breakfast not only in the dining room but on the good china. It was a thing, and it was not just a one-time occasion, but it was such a great memory. My friends would be, oh my gosh, this is really neat. She had a classic movie star elegance and look. If you've seen some of the pictures, there are some fantastic pictures in there that I adore, especially the ones in the 50s of her. And she just carried herself with such grace. I don't know how I didn't pick any of that up, but she was a wonderful example and the true definition of a lady. Mom had a really great sense of humor. Some of you have got to see an inside look, and we got to see a little bit more of that inside look. She would always tease us. Occasionally, we'd come home or whatever, and she would greet us with this, "Hi, honey." And, it, you know, that might be a little bit out of character that some people know of Mom. But she was an actress, and occasionally at Sunday school functions and parties, she had a particular country character that she would portray and do comedic readings. I can't even say that it was a dramatic reading, but she had created this character, and I do remember her telling me that early on, I think it was the first time this character made an appearance at a Sunday school event, this woman came walking in. "Hi, y'all. How you doing?" Hair everywhere, teeth blacked out, green patent leather shoes, country. And she had some friends later tell her, you know, it was halfway through this that it took me to realize that that was you. No idea. And she and Dad enjoyed acting together. Dad didn't get to do it very often, but he did get to do it occasionally at the Sunday school parties. And there was one particular Sunday school party that they did a reading of Romeo and Juliet. But Dad was dressed as Juliet. Mom was Romeo. And we have a picture of it somewhere. I wasn't able to find it for the slideshow, but hysterical. And enough so that I will tell you that Clorinda Jeans today, before she even knew I was going to talk about this, brought that memory up to me. So I was like, that was a good one. She was a great love. She had a great love of the theater. Drama was one of her majors. And she instilled that love in us. And some of my early memories, I always tell people, I was a theater baby. I grew up in the theater. My earliest memories are of her either directing a musical or being in a musical. We have a recording of me, I was two. And she played Laurie, and if any of you know Don Squibb, he played Curly. And there is a recording of me saying, "She took the broom and she mushed him out." Laurie runs after Curly with the broom. "Get out of here." But and there were many set buildings that happened in our garage that I got to help Dad with that then made it down to the theater. But one of the most fond memories that I have is that when I was in seventh grade, I had the privilege of getting to be in a musical with my mom. When I did musicals, she always would help me and instruct me and give me critical, very gentle but good criticisms of what I could do here and there. But we were able to be in the musical Annie together, and I was a little snot-nosed orphan. And she got to play, of all characters, Grace Farrell, the very exquisite and ladylike secretary to Oliver Warbucks. And it truly was a joy to do that play with her. She loved art. That was another one of her majors. We enjoyed going to museums together. And years ago, I happened to be in Los Angeles and had some free time and went to the Getty Art Museum for the first time. And I love Van Gogh, and there was the picture Irises, the real deal, the first time I had ever seen this piece of art that wasn't in a book. I got to see it with my own eyes, and I called her. I took it all in, and I stepped outside, and I called her, and I was very verklempt over it. She got very verklempt with me. Just to share the joy of seeing that piece in person. She was a painter. We have a few of her paintings, and I actually have one of her paintings in my home now that I have displayed with great pride. She also was a wonderful storyteller. And if any of you were ever, got on a phone call with her, you knew what a storyteller she was, because that was going to turn into a two-hour phone call. But she also kept alive the stories of our family and her family and our extended family, so that we have these wonderful stories that are 100 years old and that we can carry them on. It was very important that we knew our heritage. You all might not have known that Joy Lee Sechrest was a little bit of a tomboy. She once got in trouble when she was younger for wrestling with the boys outside. And it wasn't that she got in trouble wrestling. It was that she did it in a dress, in one of her good dresses. My grandmother was not very happy with that. But I was a tomboy, and there was a time when I was in junior high that I came home particularly upset. Something had happened, teenage angst. And knowing that the last thing I wanted to do as a teenager was talk about my feelings with my mom, she grabbed me and wrestled me to the ground. And we had a good old-fashioned wrestling match in my bedroom. And let me tell you what, she could throw down. It was a draw. She was determined I was not going to win, and I was determined she was not going to win, and we eventually just had to kind of call it. she also, if she ever got anywhere on time, that was a miracle. We saw a lot of movies together growing up, especially when I was little. I saw movies from the beginning to the end and the end to the beginning, meaning we were always running late. We got to the movie halfway through, so we would watch it halfway to the end, and then we'd just sit there and eat popcorn until it started again, and watch it from the beginning until when we came in, and then it was like, all right, time to go, and we'd get up and walk out halfway through. And it was kind of funny. Are they coming back? Why are they leaving? Little did they know. Wednesday was grocery day. And growing up, she would always take me to the grocery with her. And I would always get a little box of Bugles and sit in the grocery cart and eat those. It kept me quiet and it kept me from, you know, running around. And we would always pass the little toy section, and I would always want a little toy. No, we're not going to buy the toys here. They're, you know, they don't last, except paddle balls. Paddle being the operative word here. We would always get to be a paddle. Okay, well, occasionally we would get the paddle when the one we had before broke. But eventually, those paddle balls, those little strings were only held on with a little staple. That string eventually would come off. And then written on the paddle across the top would be "Love Paddle." And it would be neatly placed in the cabinet above the oven for such a time as a paddle would be needed. And we still have the last Love Paddle. It is in Mom's kitchen, in the cupboard, for old time's sake. Or if she just decided that we still, you know, weren't too old to bend over her knee and give a good smack. Manners were a big thing with Mom, and I now thank her greatly for teaching me. Please and thank you, and yes, sir, no, sir, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am. But oh my goodness, when I was a child, if I heard once, I heard 100 times, "Are your manners in your pocket?" Going to a friend's house, "Are your manners in your pocket?" "Yes, ma'am." "All right, remember to take them out." "Yes, Mom." She and Dad could cut a rug. And when I say that, I mean they were jitterbuggers. You want to talk about real jitterbuggers? They could jitterbug, y'all. Go look up jitterbugging and they could do it. And I was mortified when I was in seventh grade and having a slumber party and we're watching videos and Stray Cats struck from the Stray Cats came on. And here go Mom and Dad jitterbugging on the sleeping bags. But I'm really happy and love that memory now. But oh my gosh, turning into a 13-year-old and my parents are jitterbugging. The mortification. But they loved music. Mom adored music and passed that love on to all of us. The house was always filled with music. We all were encouraged and made to play piano. She was a wonderful soprano, for those of you lucky enough to have heard her sing. She also played piano and cornet as well. And my father was a really good trombonist, and they occasionally would do little cornet and trombone duos. And sometimes they were really great. And sometimes when they hadn't been practicing a lot because they had four kids and, you know, Dad was a doctor, and, you know, the chops would get a little loose. And sometimes it wasn't, but it was still really neat. Like I said, they encouraged our love for music. We all did have to take piano lessons. Charles got out of it the earliest before any of us. Mom would always say, "The piano is the foundation of all instruments." And I finally had to acquiesce and admit she was right when, as a music student in college, it helped me out in music theory. Yes, Mom, you were right. It was. But when the time came that I wanted to start taking guitar lessons, and even though John played guitar and Charles had played guitar for a little while, well, you know, people who play guitar have calluses on their fingers. And your point is, okay, well, you can take guitar, but you have to take piano again. Well, piano didn't last, guitar did. But she and Dad always encouraged whatever avenue of music we wanted to go down. John was in a band, a rock band in high school, that would mostly rehearse at one of the other guys' houses, but a time or two, it would be at our house. And they would set up in the garage, and magically, Mom would always have an errand to run when that happened. But we were never told to turn down, except for once. She and Dad had gone on a walk on a summer afternoon. The windows were up. I stayed home and had my amp up playing. And when they came home, they said, you need to turn that down. We can hear you halfway down the block. I think that was the only time I ever was asked to turn down. But one of the most wonderful things that Mom truly enjoyed were her grandchildren. She adored them. She adored being a grandmother. And now to set the scene, growing up, we had two rooms that we were not allowed to play in. The living room, only allowed in there to practice piano, and the dining room. Chip was the first grandchild. And this particular day, he was a toddler, and Sis and I both were home. And he was making a circle from the breakfast room into the kitchen, into the family room, out into the entry hall, around into the dining room, and back again. Just one big circle, while eating crackers and a trail of crumbs leading behind him. Going through the dining room, I don't know, for the second or third time, and crumbs trailing along behind him, Jill said, well, Mom, we both were talking, he's crumbs, there are crumbs in the dining room. Mom, Chip's getting crumbs in the dining room. That's okay. Who are you and what have you done with our mother? Where was that when we were little? But it just exemplifies how she felt about those kids. She loved that they called her affectionately Goggy, a term that was Chip came up with when learning to speak and trying to say grandmother, it came out Goggy. And she loved that so much it stuck. Forget being called grandmother, I am Goggy. She went to numerous plays and sporting events and grandparents' days and lunches at schools and thoroughly reveled in being a grandmother. When Chip was on the way as the first grandchild, a friend of hers said, Joy, grandkids are the reason you're glad you didn't kill the kids. And we're glad she didn't kill the kids, even though we definitely gave her cause to have gray hair. She only had one or two strands. She never turned gray, which I always thought was an astounding thing, especially with some of the things that we put her through. But I'm glad she didn't kill the kids. And I'm glad that I could have had a mother so wonderful and special as she, who instilled in us the love of family and art and faith and the love of a husband and wife, and who set an example for us all. So thank you for being here, because you are also an example of those who knew her and loved her and want to honor her. So thank you.
I'm Jill. I'm the oldest. Jennifer is the youngest. She's an improviser and I am not. How do you talk about your mom? Words don't seem big enough to capture the enormity of her presence and influence in my life. But when I distill it down to the very essence of who she was, I think it's she was someone I wanted to be with. She was inspiring. She was persuasive. She was so excited about whatever she was doing that before you knew it, you found yourself agreeing to help her and wanting to help her. She made things fun. When we were growing up, she was too busy to really sit down and play with us very much, but she drew us into her activities. I learned to cook and entertain, arrange flowers, clean the house, take care of younger siblings, a thousand other things by watching her and helping her. She was a lady. She never left the house without being perfectly turned out. She was elegant. I thought she was beautiful and talented, and I wanted to be just like her. She didn't tolerate vulgar or off-color language. The only time in my whole life I ever heard her say a bad word was one evening when she was cooking dinner and she was bending down in the pantry looking for something. As she straightened up, she whacked her head hard on the fire extinguisher that was on the wall there, and she said the S word. I was shocked. I was a teenager. I'd never, ever heard her talk that way. Later on, I thought it was really funny. Her expression of choice when she was thoroughly put out was, "Oh, snot." She'd been an English teacher, and she insisted that we children speak properly. She corrected us tirelessly. To this day, we are all grammar geeks, and when we're together, we tease each other about grammar faux pas and awkward sentence structure. But she was also a lady in the very best sense, meaning that she extended to others genuine kindness and respect. Charles described her as gracious, saying that he had never heard her speak in an ugly way to anyone, even in the midst of a disagreement. I realized I never had either. She would tell you what she thought and call you to account if necessary, but never in a belittling way. If she caught herself about to say something negative about someone else, she would often stop short and say, "Oh, shut up, Joy." If something wonderful happened, she was as excited as I was. If it had been a bad day, she could comfort me and give me fresh perspective. But her bucking up didn't always extend to sympathy. Sometimes it involved yanking a knot in my tail and telling me to get over myself and consider other people. She would talk and listen to me anytime, anywhere. She was the first person I wanted to see when I got home from school every day. We had many conversations at midnight. One of my favorite things to do was sit on her bathroom counter while she was getting ready to go somewhere and talk to her. When I went away to college, we talked by phone every 2 weeks, late at night on Saturdays, because that's when long-distance phone calls were cheapest. And in between times, we wrote copious letters. Hers were typed on an electric typewriter, single-spaced, often 10 or 15 pages long. We both kept all those letters, and I have them now in two very large ring binders. She read to us every night. She was a wonderful actress, and she read in such an exciting way that you always wanted her to go on to the next chapter. And she read Bible stories to us and prayed with us every night until we got old enough to do it for ourselves. Mom loved us in an intentional way. What she intended was for us to turn out well. Yes, she wanted us to have careers that we enjoy and to get married and to be happy, but most of all, she wanted us to mature into people of good character who were not self-centered, whose highest priority was to love God and serve God and love other people. She and Daddy modeled generosity. They did it quietly, without any show. We always had wonderful Christmases with bountiful gifts, but I remember one Christmas when I was about 10, telling her how many more presents some friends of ours had gotten than we had. She told me that she and Daddy thought it was much more important to be generous to people in need than to spend extravagantly on ourselves. She meant for us to behave, to take responsibility, to respect others, and she was a creative and persistent disciplinarian. She tried to make the punishment fit the crime. When Charles was a teenager, he went through a period where he wouldn't clean up his room. After a number of warnings, Mom resorted to picking up whatever items he had left lying about and taking them upstairs and then up a folding ladder in the ceiling to the attic. If Charles wanted something, he had to go to the attic to retrieve it. This went on for some time, and then Charles decided he would take some items of hers to the attic. I asked him what happened next, and he said, "I don't remember, but it wasn't good." She was not gracious that day. One of the best lessons she ever taught me did not involve punishment. When I was about 9 and Charles 8, he and I were having a verbal knockdown drag out in the playroom. Mom came down the hall just in time to hear me yell at Charles, "You are worse than the devil." She appeared in the playroom doorway with a horrified look on her face, and she said, "Jill Marie, how dare you say something like that? He is not worse than the devil. No one is worse than the devil, and you better get down on your knees and ask Jesus to forgive you." She hustled Charles out, and I'm sure he got a talking to elsewhere. But I spent the next little while on my knees in shame-faced repentance and contemplating the seriousness and power of words. Her faith in God was deep and quiet. She said, "I have the faith of a child, by which she meant simply, she believed what the Bible said and she followed it. She didn't make a show, but as Phil mentioned, I saw her many a night late, sitting in the bathroom counter, reading her devotional book just before she went to bed. She prayed. She prayed for us. She prayed for herself, that she would be a better person. She prayed for other people. And when my father got Alzheimer's, she really struggled. She asked over and over, how could God allow such a wonderful man to have such a terrible disease? This is the only time I ever remember her questioning God. And I wouldn't be a bit surprised if she has had a word or two with him about that in the last few days." Mom and Daddy modeled love. When he got home from work, the first thing they did was find each other. He would put his arms around her and kiss her and smile at her in that adoring way he had. And she would look up at him and bat her eyes at him and say something along the lines of, "You big, handsome man." They never lost their romance. I never heard them argue or say an unkind word to each other. If they had a difference of opinion, they had discussions that were respectful until they came to a mutual decision. We children were a high priority, but we knew they came first with each other, and we couldn't play them off against each other. If something we wanted to do involved pros and cons, Mom's standard answer was, "I'll discuss it with your father." When we were going on vacation, Mom was a meticulous packer. Packing took days and involved many lists. She always said she was a Sechrest, and the Sechrests were slow and thorough. Invariably, she wasn't ready to leave on time. As Charles reminded me, Daddy would say, "We are going to leave bright and early at 6 a.m. And we would leave bright and early at 2 p.m. Mom ran a few minutes late for most things. And she would say, "I'll go when I'm ready." As we kept vigil with her the last couple of days of her life, I had to smile, imagining she was saying, "I'll go when I'm ready." My father has been gone 10 years, and my mom missed him every day of it. Charles said that when Mom got to heaven, Daddy was going to greet her with, "I knew it took you a long time to pack, but this is ridiculous." Mom had lost most of her ability to speak in the last couple of years, but she still knew us and knew the wonderful women who helped take care of her. And her face would light up when one of us arrived, especially John. She smiled every day and seemed content. Several months ago, when I came in, I said, "Mom, how are you doing today?" And she said, "Well, I'm 100%. Two weekends ago, when I was here, I was transferring her from wheelchair to bed. I hugged her up against me and I said, "Mom, I love you. I love you so much." And she laid her head on my chest and she said, "Bless you." And she has. She has blessed all of us and everyone who knew her. The brilliant, sparkling, joyful woman that was Mom.
Please stand if you're able as we sing this hymn of thanksgiving.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
You may be seated.
I want to use passages from Ecclesiastes 3 and honor the life of Joy Allen and how she lived her life as told in these passages. There is a time to be born. Joy Lee Sechrest Allen was born September 14, 1932 in Johnson City to Paul and Alma Lee Sechrest. She was a graduate of Science Hill High School and East Tennessee State University and taught high school English, speech, and drama in Baltimore, Maryland and Kingsport, Tennessee. In John 3:3, it says, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. So Joy Allen was born again, baptized at First Christian Church around the age of 9, and was a longtime member. There is a time of living. Joy Allen lived to be 90 years of age. There is a time to plant. Joy was a gifted actress and singer and one of the funniest people ever to step foot on a stage. Her acting and directing prowess were evident in many fine productions at the Johnson City Community Theater and at First Christian Church, where she was a longtime faithful member. She belonged to the Johnson City Music Club, the Washington County Medical Auxiliary, and the Shady Oak Garden Club. And her beautiful flower arrangement often took first place at flower shows she entered. She loved to entertain and was a superb cook and warm and welcoming hostess. For many years, she blessed numerous women through her classes in makeup and fashion and her clothing store, Joy Allen Classic. There is a time to die. Joy Allen passed from this life on June 8, 2023. She lived a long life and is now reaping the reward of her long commitment to her Lord. There is a time to mourn. She is survived by her children, Jill Allen Lagerberg, Charles Allen Jr. and his wife Barbara, John Allen and his wife Leslie, and Jennifer Allen. By her grandchildren, Charles Chip Allen III, Wetch Allen, and Carin Gunter and her husband Evan, and by her sister, Gail Thompson. There is a time to love and to embrace. Joy's starring role was as a wife and mother. She and Ed were married in 1956 and were shining examples of a loving Christian marriage and parenting. Joy managed a hectic schedule with aplomb. She took enthusiastic interest in the myriad school, extracurricular, and church activities of four children. She always had time to listen, and her counsel was wise and to the point. By example, she taught life lessons in being grateful, generous, kind, and unselfish. There was a delicious home-cooked supper on the table every night. She made every holiday festive and joyous. Gagi and her three grandchildren mutually adored each other, and she delighted in planning exciting activities and treats for them. She never lost her playfulness or her curiosity about learning new things. She always took time to let Ed know how special he was to her and how much she loved him. Her faith in God was quiet and deep, and she loved and served him with her whole heart. There is a time to remember. You have just heard of many memories from Jill and Jennifer about their mom. I personally remember the many times that I had the privilege to assist her for many years in several presentations and productions at First Christian Church. She was always so very kind and generous to me and sought to see that I knew what she needed and assisted me in all that she could. She never missed a chance to thank me for my help and made me appreciate her and to be willing to always help her each time she asked. There was no one as kind, generous, and compassionate as Joy Allen was to me. There is a time to rejoice. We do rejoice that Joy Allen was a Christian and now in the presence of her family and friends who preceded her in death. I think we all need to remember this. You have not been left behind. She's just gone ahead and will be there when we get there. Do not let your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house had many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a plate for you? And if I go and prepare a plate for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
All of us are old enough that occasionally we look back over life and see how God has blessed us. And I think one of the things we conclude is the older we get, that God has blessed us through the individuals he has brought into our lives. And my Shirley and I enjoyed so much getting to be acquainted with and sharing some delightful times with Ed and Joy. We enjoyed Sunday school class together. We enjoyed worship time at church together. And then we enjoyed partying together. We went out to dinner a lot. We celebrated special occasions with one another. And I especially look forward to the time when we were going to be entertained at the Allen House, because I knew the real china would be there. And the real silver would be at the table, and it would be elegant. I think Joy came to the conclusion early in life that it doesn't cost a bit more to go first class. And first class was on her agenda. Joy and Ed Allen contributed so much to the church, and they contributed so much to our community. And we're just grateful that God gave us the privilege of having them share their lives and their generosity with us. Now, Joy helped the looks of Johnson City. She went off and studied coloring. And she came back and she taught us about we should determine whether or not we were a spring, or a fall, or a summer, or a winter, and we would determine the cosmetics that we use based on that understanding, or the kind of clothes that we would wear based on that understanding. And my Shirley had all of Joy's books at our house. I would sneak a peek every now and then at those books. Shirley understood what those books meant, and she adhered to that understanding. I still haven't figured out whether I'm a winter or a fall, a spring or a summer, but I guess Joy would approve of that. Joy put on pageants at the church. I've never been a pageant person, and I accuse her of coercing me into participating, but I really wasn't coerced. It was one of those deals when Joy Allen asks you to do something, you just naturally say yes and do it. And so Dr. Del Noel Brown and I were recruited by Joy to be in the Christmas pageant. We had to rehearse our lines, and we had to appear for practice and even for a dress rehearsal. And when the occasion came, Del Noel and I did quite well. After all that memorizing our lines and all that practice and all that dress rehearsal, we said our lines, "Behold, a star in the east." It was well rehearsed, and it turned out rather well, and we were very proud. That was my first and I think my last appearance in a pageant, but you couldn't say no to that delightful lady. The 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians is known by all Bible people as the love chapter. And like you, I've read that chapter over and over and over again, but I always focus on the last line, verse 13, which is the last verse in chapter 13. And in that line, we're told these words, "And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love." And when I read that passage, I think, these three remain. What does it mean, remain? Well, I'll tell you what it means to me. At the end of the day, these three remain. When all is said and done, these three remain. And when the books of life are closed, these three remain. There's faith. Faith was an important part of Joy Allen's life. She believed in God. That was a solid belief. She believed in God, and she understood that he was holy and righteous and just, and she understood that he rewards those who diligently seek him. And that's why she was reading that little book, because she was diligently seeking him. And the Bible tells us that the heavens declare the glory of God. I doubt if anybody appreciated that more than she did, because that was poetic, and that declared beauty. The heavens, wow, declare the beauty of God. She beheld that beauty, and I think she felt it. And the earth shows forth his handiwork, and I think probably with such a poetic heart that she had, that as she went through life, she saw, and the earth shows forth that remarkable handiwork of God. And she delighted in that. And then she liked good music. And that's an important part of our worship here today, good music. And you know, there's an anthem that is sung in heaven. And I suspect that she has volunteered for the choir. And that anthem is this: Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was, who is, and who will ever be. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Not only did she believe in God, but boy, she had a faith in Jesus Christ. She recognized the fact that the Bible told the truth when it said he's the only begotten Son of God. The Bible told the truth when he said he is to be your Lord and your Savior. And then that wonderful promise that you don't want to ever overlook, when the Bible says you and I have an advocate before the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And Joy has stepped in the presence of Jesus, and Jesus has introduced her to God, his Father, because he's her advocate before the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And when you leave here today, take that remembrance with you. You have an advocate before the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Her knowledge of the Word of God led her to accept God's redemption in Christ. And she accepted Jesus as her Lord and as her Savior. And so there remains at the end faith. She had faith. It was real. And then there is hope. Isn't it sad for anyone to go through life without hope? That brings on despair, doesn't it? But she had hope. And she's discovered the reality of that hope, and that it was solid and real, because now she knows the promise that was given to be absent in the body is to be present with the Lord. That's our hope. Whenever we lose a loved one's presence with us in this life, and they're in Christ Jesus, we have that hope. And we leave the body there in Buena Vista, but, you know, to depart from the body is to be present with the Lord. Christ has indeed been raised, says the Bible, from the dead. And he is the first fruit, the Bible says, of those who have fallen asleep. For as in Adam all have died, so in Christ all will be made alive. And then I'd just like to read a passage of scripture that I think really brings to life the hope that we have, thanks to God and his love for us. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep, or to grieve like those who are without hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command and with the voice of the archangel and with the trump call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the air to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. And so when the books of life are closed, there remains faith, there remains hope. And finally, there remains love. And you know the greatest thing about love? The greatest thing about love is nothing can separate us from the love of God. In his word, he has said, neither death nor life or anything. There is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. What does that mean? That means that right now, here in this place, you and I are surrounded by and embraced by the love of God. And what does that mean? Joy Allen, right now, is surrounded by and embraced by the love of God. And the love of God is a bond that extends from this life into the next life. And so we have that bond with her. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And so three things remain: faith, hope, and love. Joy Allen had a lot of faith. Joy Allen has claimed her hope. And Joy Allen is enjoying the love of God. Comfort one another. Encourage one another with these words: faith, hope, love.
Please stand if you are able as we sing this hymn of assurance. Standing for the benediction.
Just now, our Heavenly Father, we thank you once again that you, by your grace and mercy and love, have allowed Joy Allen to touch our lives. We thank you now for the gift of remembering that will be treasured from this day forward as we think of her and how she touched our lives, and the legacy of love and faith she has left for her children, for her grandchildren, for all the members of her family, and even for our friends. We thank you. She leaves a legacy of love and of faith. We pray, our Heavenly Father, you will accept our thanks, and we thank you that the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, will abide now in the hearts of those who will miss her the most. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.